This video is brought to you by my supporters on Patreon, Buy Me a Coffee, Nas.io, and YouTube. If you wish to support me, you can find the links below. What's the first thing you do when you enter a dark room? You look for the light switch and turn it on. And when you do, the whole room turns bright instantly. If no one ever told you that light travels at a finite speed, you wouldn't even think that the speed is something that could be measured. Right? Of course, we know the value today, what with all the sophisticated measuring instruments and the precise clocks we have. So it surprised me when I learned that the first official measurement of the speed of light was given in 1676. And the way it was figured out back then was absolute genius. And we're gonna look at that story in this video. My name's Pranav, you're watching Science is Dope. Let's begin. The speed of light is 299792458 meters per second. Or if you ask a student who is trying to find a quick solution to a problem, that's 3×10⁸ meters per second. That's frighteningly fast. No wonder you feel like it's instantaneous. In fact, till about the 1600s, no one even considered light to be something that traveled with finite speed. They would say that light was simply the presence of brightness and the absence of darkness. And this idea was prevalent throughout the world. Even Johannes Kepler, the astronomer who gave us the laws of planetary motion, thought that light speed was infinite. And his argument was, hey, empty space presents no obstacle to light, so it should travel instantaneously. But we were beginning to see arguments for why the speed of light could be finite around this time. French mathematician Pierre de Fermat argued in favor of a finite light speed. And to put all this debate to rest, the first attempt to measure the speed was made by the father of experimental science himself, Galileo Galilei. Galileo set out with an assistant and two covered lamps. He stood on a hilltop and his assistant stood on an opposite hilltop a mile away. Galileo then uncovered his lamp and his assistant was to uncover his lamp as soon as he saw the light from Galileo's lamp. Galileo would see this and measure if there was any time lag between the two light sources. Unfortunately, he didn't notice anything. They even tried repeating the experiment across different distances, but the results were still inconclusive. He figured that light speed may either be infinite or maybe it travels way too fast for the speed to be measured across these small distances. And he was right. If they somehow had more accurate timekeeping devices, this experiment would have yielded a time lag of 11 microseconds. Not to mention they had no conception of reaction times back then. But Galileo did do one thing that enabled the next person to be able to measure the speed of light. He started using the telescope for astronomy. And thanks to the telescope, people were now able to see over longer and longer distances. Distances over which light speed could be measured. By the second half of the 1600s, there were astronomers everywhere in Europe, all looking at the stars with their own telescopes. And one such was a Dutch astronomer, Ole Romer. I'm probably butchering his name right now. If any of you know how to say it, let me know. Correct me in the comments. Now, one thing that Ole Romer was doing was studying the orbit of Io, which is a moon of Jupiter. If you ever get a chance to look at Jupiter through a telescope, please do so, because this is what you'll see. Jupiter with four dots near it, and these are the Galilean moons of Jupiter. There's a whole story on how Galileo discovered them, and that helped him establish heliocentrism, which I've covered in this video here. Now, like I said, these moons are going around Jupiter, and the innermost moon is Io. Io orbits Jupiter every 42.5 hours, that's about 1.7 Earth days. Now, this was important because Io's orbital period could be used by sailors anywhere to determine the time of day. Right, because if he used Earth-based measurements of time like the position of the sun or the moon or a pocket watch or a clock, the time you'd get would depend on where you are on Earth, right? And a sailor's ship might be traveling eastwards or westwards. meaning you keep changing time zones and your pocket watch is no longer telling you the right time. The suggestion was then to use a non-Earth-based measurement of time, like the orbital period of Io or the eclipse period of Io, because during every orbit, Io would go behind Jupiter and would become invisible from Earth. And when this happens, it's called an eclipse of Io. And for this purpose, our man Ole Romer was busy making the tables of the eclipse when an eclipse of Io would occur, when he noticed something. Io's eclipse timings would occur sooner and sooner when Earth was moving closer to Jupiter in its orbit, and later when it was moving further away from Jupiter. He reasoned that this couldn't be because Io's orbital period itself was getting faster or slower. It had to have been because light itself took longer to travel from Jupiter to Earth when Earth was moving further away than when it was moving closer. He looked at the charts of Io's eclipses and determined that these sometimes occurred up to 11 minutes earlier than predicted, or sometimes 11 minutes later than predicted. So this time difference between the earliest and latest eclipse was some 22 minutes, and they must happen when the Earth was at opposite ends of its orbit, and so light must take 22 minutes to cover the length of Earth's orbital diameter, and the speed of light was simply the orbital diameter divided by 22 minutes. And it was the Dutch physicist Christian Huygens who calculated the speed. Again, I'm probably not saying his name right, somebody correct me in the comments. So the speed came out to be 220,000 kilometers per second, which is 27% off from its modern value. The error was mostly due to the error in calculation of the orbital diameter of the Earth and the error in time measurement devices back then. Now, remember how this was originally done so that the sailors would have a non-Earth-based time measurement system? Well, that actually never panned out because it was too impractical. Imagine using a telescope to look at Jupiter's moons on a rocking, unsteady ship in the middle of the sea. Also, for 6 months in a year, Jupiter would be in the daytime sky. And you can't use a telescope in the day, what with the sun being too bright and all. So although timekeeping using Io failed, we were able to use the same data to measure the speed of light. And even though the value measured was inaccurate, it showed people that something like this could be done. The speed of light was finite and measurable, and that probably inspired the experiments that followed. The next significant contribution was from James Bradley, a British astronomer who computed the speed of light using stellar aberration. Not gonna go into detail on what he did in this video, but I've left sources below. He found the speed of light to be 301,000 kilometers per second, which is less than 1% off from its modern value. We then come to James Clerk Maxwell, who found a theoretical value for the speed of light, whose equations of electromagnetism found the speed of light to be C equals 1 over square root of mu naught epsilon naught, which is about 299792 kilometers per second. By this time, tracks were beginning to appear in the models of classical physics, and the final nail in the coffin was driven by Michelson and Morley, who showed experimentally that light speed was independent of the frame of reference. The speed of light was a cosmic speed barrier, and based on this, Albert Einstein came up with his theory of relativity, with which he showed that it wasn't the speed of light that would change based on the frame of reference we are looking at it from. It was length or time that would contract or expand, keeping the speed of light constant. The fact that length can contract or that time can expand is so counterintuitive to us. That's because we never get to see these relativistic effects. They're only visible at extremely high speeds, close to the speed of light or at extremely high gravitational fields. Remember how in the movie Interstellar, there was a planet where time passed by 7 Earth years for every 1 hour on that planet? That is a result of gravitational time dilation from Einstein's general theory of relativity. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make is that with Einstein, the speed of light became so important in the field of physics that it dominated our understanding of the universe. Today, the speed of light is recognized as a universal constant on which all our measurements of lengths are based. 1 meter, a standard measurement of length, is defined using the speed of light. And to think that all this began with sailors who were trying to figure out which part of the ocean they were in. If you like my content, it'd be really awesome if you could support me, because that becomes my main source of income. You can give me a one-time support using one of these options, or give me continued support using one of these options, for which you will get perks that you see on your screen. One of those perks is a private WhatsApp group that you get to join, where we do stuff like this. One of our members is an astronomer, and so we have amateur astronomy sessions over Zoom call. So if you're interested in things like that, do join. I want to thank my highest tier supporters on Patreon and YouTube. If you support me in my highest tiers, you can get your name displayed on the video like this. If you like this video, you might also like this one, where I talked about this transition from classical physics to modern physics. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, remember, science is dope.